Good morning, everyone. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about sensors and transducers. So what are different kinds of sensors or transducers available for us, and what are the uses of those sensors in measuring different physical quantities, and what is exactly that transducer is? So all those concepts we'll discuss in this lecture. First, let us discuss what is transducer first. So transducer is nothing but it is device. It converts one form of energy into another form of energy. For example, if you look at it, so a microphone, so it converts sound energy into electrical energy. And speakers, they convert electrical energy into sound energy. So like this, transducer is a device that converts the other physical temperature, force, okay, so remaining physical quantities like displacement into another form of energy like voltage. Okay, this is the work, actual work of transducer. So transducer is nothing but a device that converts any physical, okay, mechanical or magnetic, chemical, so etc. Parameters into electrical voltages and current. Here, there is only slight variation between sensors and transducers. That is nothing but sensors are used only to detect or sense something. Okay, so they measure something and they give its output to some other device. Whereas transducer is nothing but it converts that input into another form of electrical energy. So this is the basic difference between sensors and transducers. So next, coming to different types of transducers available, so we have electrical transducers, okay, mechanical transducers, so based on how they are going to convert the energies. And the basic transducers which we are going to discuss in this session are nothing but active and passive transducers. So active transducer, so this active transducer is nothing but this is a transducer, so that generates an equivalent amount of electrical signals, so directly in response to the physical parameter that is applied to the transducer. For example, okay, we have applied displacement, okay, so it will convert that into voltage. If we apply temperature, it is going to give us in the form of electric voltage. So like that, so any transducer converts the other physical parameters into equivalent electrical parameters such as voltage and current. So the example for active transducer is nothing but piezoelectric sensors and photovoltaic cells. So piezoelectric sensors, they convert pressure into equivalent voltage, okay, and photovoltaic cells, so they convert luminous intensity, okay, that is nothing but light, okay, so into electrical voltage. So this is the function of piezoelectric sensors and photovoltaic cells. Next, coming to the another classification, that is nothing but passive transducers. So here the conversion is done, but not in a direct way. These are related to the electrical parameters such as resistance, inductance and capacitance. That means whenever physical quantity is applied to passive transducers, they generate equivalent amount of electric current, okay, so by varying the electrical parameters present in them, okay. So if you want to determine the electrical equivalent voltage for applied input, so we need to measure them across the resistors, inductors or capacitors. This is the main difference between active and passive transducers. So active transducers are self generating devices. They don't require power source for their operation. They directly, whenever we apply input to them, they directly sense them, they convert them into equivalent electrical voltage and give us the output. So whereas passive transducers, they operate under the energy controlling applications. That means they require energy source, that means such as current source or voltage source for their operation, and so they will not give the direct voltage or current they will vary the electrical parameters such as resistance, inductance or capacitance present in their circuits. And we need to measure the equivalent value which is present across those electrical parameters. So then we will be able to obtain the electrical voltage from the passive transducer circuits. So the examples are of a strain gauges and thermistors. Okay. So in strain gauges, we are going to measure the pressure whenever the resistance of circuit is going to be varied. So at the time we need to find the voltage. That means whenever we apply the pressure or some electrical parameters are going to be changed in strain gauges, then the equivalent voltage can be found out. Next, thermistors. Similarly, in thermistors, whenever temperature is applied to thermistors, so their resistance will be varied. So which we need to measure with the help of some ammeters which are calibrated to read the root mean square value of that particular change. So this is how the active and passive transducers work. Active transducers are self-generating devices. They don't require power for their operation. So passive transducers require power for their operation and they will not give directly the electrical quantities. So they will vary the electrical parameters present in them, and from them we need to calculate the changes. This is how these two are going to work. So now first of all, let us discuss active transducer, that is nothing but a piezoelectric transducer. So piezoelectric transducer is an active transducer. Okay, so it produces electrical quantity which is equivalent to the pressure input. That means whenever we supply pressure to the piezoelectric transducer, it will convert it directly into voltage. So how it is done, with the help of what kind of materials it will be able to do the operation. So let us see. So in piezoelectric transducers, so we have some crystals, okay, so such as quartz, Roschel salt and barium titanate. So these produce an electromotive force whenever they are placed under stress. Stress is nothing but application of pressure on certain material. Whenever we apply force, okay, so that force per unit area is nothing but the pressure. So that pressure is detected by the crystals. So those crystals convert that pressure into equivalent voltage. So this is the function of crystals present in piezoelectric transducers. So only these three materials have such capability of determining what is equivalent EMF produced whenever pressure is applied on them. So here how it is done, so this is the construction of piezoelectric transducer. So here in the middle we have crystal, so such as quartz or Roschel salt or barium titanate. So any crystal is placed at the middle. So at the bottom we have base and at the top we have four summing. So four summing member is nothing but, so this is also a kind of material, so where we are going to apply force on it. So whenever force is applied on the top of the piezoelectric transducer, so that force per unit area is nothing but pressure. So that pressure will enter through pressure port and it is applicable on the crystal which is present at the center of the piezoelectric transducer. So whenever that pressure is detected by the quartz or any kind of crystal which is placed in the construction of piezoelectric transducer, it will generate equivalent voltage for the application of pressure. Okay, so the expression which we are going to obtain for EMF or voltage that is generated whenever pressure is applied on the top of the force summing member, that is nothing but on the top of the crystal, so is given by V naught equal to Q by C. So Q is nothing but the charge developed on the top and bottom plates of the crystal, and C is the internal capacitance between those two. That means it is analogous to capacitor that contains two plates, that is, one is top plate, another one is bottom plate. So in between these two plates, charge is going to be built such that capacitance is developed. So if you find out the charge for the ratio of that capacitor, we'll be able to obtain the total voltage that is produced whenever the pressure has been applied to the piezoelectric transducer. So this is how the sensor is going to work. Okay. So here the quartz crystal or Roche salt crystal or barium titanate crystal plates act like two plates of capacitor, and they are going to develop charge between those two plates. So that charge developed is going to be fine, and then the capacitance of that internal plates is to be determined. So with the help of this voltage equation, V naught equal to Q by C, we will be able to get the voltage that is equivalent to the applied pressure in piezoelectric transducer. So next, let us see some passive transducers which are helpful in the measurement of displacement. So here, for measurement of displacement, we have many methods available. So we have different types of passive transducers available. So here, passive transducers, in the sense, passive transducers are nothing but whenever physical quantities such as displacement, velocity, force, temperature, okay, pressure, anything are going to be applied, so they convert them into equivalent electric voltages. So how? Not directly. So but they vary the temperature, I mean they vary the resistance or inductance or capacitance values present in their circuits. And if you measure the voltage across them, then we will be able to obtain the electrical quantity from passive transducers. So here in displacement sensors, okay, so we are going to measure displacement. Displacement is nothing but the length of the path traveled by certain body. So if a body that moves from one position to another position, okay, so in a straight line format, then the length between those two points is nothing but displacement. So displacement is nothing but physical quantity, okay, but not electrical quantity. So this physical quantity is going to be converted into electrical quantity with the help of displacement sensors, okay. So since it is passive transducer, it requires one power source for their operation, and many displacement sensors are available for measuring the displacement. So among them we have these three. First we are going to discuss about these three. Those are nothing but resistive transducer, inductive transducer, capacitive transducer, which are constructed with the help of resistance, inductance and capacitors. Similarly, we have another displacement sensor available, that is nothing but LVDT, okay? So linear variable differential transformer. So we'll, at last we will discuss about LVDT, but first we will discuss how displacement is measured with the help of resistive transducer. So resistive transducer contains only resistances in them. So with the help of that resistance variance, okay, the whenever the voltage across that resistor is going to be changed, so that is measured, and we can measure the displacement with the help of that resistance variance. So this is the circuit we are going to use for the determination of displacement using resistive transducer. So this resistive transducer contains one voltage source, that means alternating current source or voltage source, anything you may think. Okay, so we require source, because it is passive transducer, we require one source for their operation, and it contains one resistance. So these two are connected in parallel, and here if you observe at point C, we have one movable sliding contact. So this is helpful for joining the body, which is going to produce some displacement in the resistive transducer. Whenever the body is connected to this point, so it will move along the path of resistance such that its position can be varied. It is going to produce some displacement in the transducer. So by measuring the voltage across the terminals AC will be able to obtain output voltage. So now with the help of these expressions, so mathematically the relation between two voltages, okay, and distances produced in them is written as V naught by Vs equal to AC by AV. So V naught is the resultant voltage that is produced once the body is connected to the moving sliding contact. So when our body is connected to the mobile sliding contact, so there is a change in the resistance. Okay, since it is potentiometer, its resistance can be varied. So it is this resistance is varied due to the mobile sliding contact. So at that time, if you determine the voltage across these two terminals AC, so AC is nothing but the displacement produced due to the body connected to it. So it may move to the left or right, so based on the body which is connected. So if you determine the length AC, okay, so that is nothing but the displacement. And if you determine the voltage across the terminals AC, that is nothing but the output voltage. And Vs is the applied source, okay, so which is required for the operation of transducer. And AB is the total length of the terminal or resistance. So these are the general relations between these two displacements and these two voltages. Now what is our interest? Our interest is to find out V naught. V naught is nothing but the electrical quantity, so which is resulted due to the application of mobile body connected to the sliding contact. So whenever that body is connected, it creates displacement AC. Okay, so whenever we find V naught, so which is nothing but the AC by AB into Vs. So if you determine the output voltage with the expression V naught equal to AC by AB into Vs, so that is nothing but the resultant voltage that is equivalent to the displacement that is created in the resistive transducer. So how it is done? First we need to measure the length of the displacement, and then we need to measure the length of the terminals between AB, and then it is multiplied by the total current source, okay, or voltage, okay. So V naught equal to AC by AB into Vs, which is the equivalent voltage for the applied displacement whenever the body is connected to that particular moving sliding contact. So next, we are able to find out the displacement with the help of inductive transducers also. So inductive transducers contain only inductances in them. So here in the inductive transducers, we have two contacts, those are nothing, two windings. So those are nothing but primary winding and two secondary windings. So at the left side, we have one primary winding, and at the right side, we have two secondary windings. They are connected in opposition in series. That means negative terminal is connected to the positive terminal of another inductor. That means another secondary winding, and similarly vice versa. Okay. So that means this is going to produce the differential voltage for us. Okay. So in the middle we have one core. So for this core we need to connect the body which creates the displacement. So that displacement is measured with the help of these windings. So mathematically the output voltage V naught can be written as, so V naught equal to Vs1 minus Vs2, the difference of the voltages across the secondary windings present at the right side. So whenever this core is at the central position, so equal voltages will be developed on secondary windings. Okay. So S1 and S2. So at that time, both voltages are same. So difference, if you calculate the difference, then it will be zero. Whenever displacement is created, that means whether the body creates a displacement either towards the left side or right side, then only we will have resultant voltage. Okay. So which is equivalent to either positive value or negative value based on the displacement. So if it is moved towards the left side, so we'll be getting Vs1 as greater, and VS2 as lesser. That means output voltage will be positive. So then that resultant value is nothing but the resultant displacement created by the body. So whenever this core is moved to right side, so then VS2 is greater than VS1, the resultant output voltage will be negative. So then the resultant voltage will have a phase relationship in response to the secondary winding S2. So that is how the output is calculated whenever we have a core that is displayed towards either left or right, or if it is placed at the center, that means if it is balanced by both sides, so then V0 will be 0. Similarly, we have a capacitive transducer for the measurement of displacement, but here it is constructed with the help of two capacitor plates. One is fixed plate and the one is movable plate. So now I think you understand where we need to connect the body which is going to create displacement for the movable plate. So since this movable plate is movable, so the displacement, okay, so the body whose displacement is going to be measured is connected to the capacitive plate which is movable. So whenever this body creates some displacement, the distance between these two plates is going to be varied. So that is calculated with the help of capacitance, so which is developed between the two plates, okay. And now whenever we determine the voltage across this capacitance, we will be able to measure what is the total displacement created by the body. So here the displacement, the distance between these two capacitor plates is given by the expression D equal to epsilon into A by C. So here epsilon is about the permittivity of the capacitance and A is the area of these two capacitors and C is the capacitance of the total capacitance circuit. So whenever this distance is going to be varied, which is created by the displacement, so if you determine the voltage across the capacitance with the help of integration, so then we'll be able to obtain total voltage which is equivalent to the displacement created by the body in terms of electrical parameters. So this is how these three transducers, resistive transducer and inductive transducer and capacitive transducer, are helpful in determining the resultant displacement, which is nothing but physical quantity in response to the electrical quantities, that is nothing but the in electrical parameters. So here all these three are nothing but the passive transducers. They require one source for their operation. Now we have another kind of transducer that is known as linear variable differential transducer, which is capable of finding out displacement, okay. So with the help of same inductive transformer, okay. So the construction, we have discussed about inductive transducer. So it is just the modification of that inductive transducer where complete details are furnished here, okay. So this is also known as differential transformer. So which is nothing but the passive inductive transformer. So the construction will look like this. So it contains one hollow former. So inside we have at the center one soft iron core which is made by nickel and steel alloy. Okay. So and then we have one primary winding P1 and we have two secondary windings which are placed at identical distance either sides of the primary winding, and to the primary winding we are going to connect one alternating current source. Because we already discussed that passive transducers require sources, energy sources for their operation. So now how it is going to function, how it is going to produce the equivalent voltage for the application of displacement, let us discuss now. So here we are seeing arm, okay. So this arm, this is where we are going to connect the body which is going to create displacement in the soft iron core. So as we discussed in inductive transform, sorry, inductive transducer, so the same operation is going to be used in LVDT also. So whenever that body is created, whenever that body is connected to the arm, so it is going to produce displacement. So which places the soft iron core either towards left side or right side? Or if it doesn't create any displacement, the soft iron core will be present at the center itself. Okay. So whenever the soft iron core is at the central position, so equivalent voltages will be developed across the secondary winding S1 and S2. So since it is at the normal position, since it is differential transformer, it is going to generate the differential voltage. So previously we have seen how those two windings are connected in series opposition. That means plus one inductor positive terminal is connected to the negative terminal of another inductor winding. Okay, so two secondaries are available. So one positive terminal of the inductor is going to connect to the negative terminal of the another inductor. That is nothing but the series opposition. So that is how we are going to get the differential output, such as E naught equal to ES1 minus ES2, difference of the two secondary windings. So here secondary windings only play a very important role in determination of output voltage. Understood? So whenever it is in normal position, ES1 value will be equal to ES2 value. So the difference voltage will be zero. So whenever this body which is connected to arm created some displacement, the soft iron core will move either left or towards the right. So whenever it is moved towards the left side, so here you can see that position. So at the middle in the figure B, we have the soft iron core which is present at the center. So where equivalent voltages will be developed across the two windings, secondary windings, ES1 and ES2 will be equal. So differential voltage E0 will be zero. Okay. So that is why there is no resultant voltage. So now whenever the body which is connected at the central arm, okay, so if it creates displacement towards the left side, so now more voltage will be developed at the secondary winding S1, left side. Okay. So here the voltage developed across the S1 will be greater than the developed across the secondary winding S2. That means ES1 is greater than ES2. So now if you take the difference, ES1 minus ES2 will be positive. So that means whenever the core is moved to left side, E0 is positive, and its phase with respect to the applied source in the primary winding, so will be 0 degrees. That means these two voltages will be in phase. Okay, the applied electric source voltage or current will be in phase with the resultant obtained voltage. And if it is moved to right side, as shown in the figure C, whenever the body connected at the arm created the displacement, and if the position of the soft iron core is moved towards the right side, so now the voltage developed across the secondary winding S2 will be greater than the winding S1. So now ES2 is greater than ES1. So now if you take the resultant, what we will be able to obtain? So that is nothing but the negative voltage. So it is due to the displacement created by the arm. So ES2 is greater than the ES1. So difference voltage expression is nothing but E0 equal to ES1 minus ES2. Since ES2 is greater, E0 will be negative. And if you consider the phase relationships now, so here you can see the phase relationships. So whenever the output voltage is negative, so it will have 180 degree out of phase with the applied source at the primary winding. So here in these graphs, you can see the output voltages and their phases. So at position O, so the soft iron core will be at central position. There is no output voltage, there is no displacement. Since there is no displacement, so whenever the voltage, whenever the displacement moves the central iron core towards the left side, okay, at center, I mean at the point A. So we'll have positive voltage. That is why we have shown the voltage at the right side, which is nothing but the positive voltage. And the phase relationship is in phase. That means there is no phase relationship. That is 0 degree phase difference is present. And whenever that the displacement, that means that body connected to the iron core creates the displacement towards the right side. So since the resultant output voltage is negative, so it will have a negative voltage, which is shown at the left side, and the phase relationships will be 180 degree out of phase with the applied current source at the primary wire. So this is how we are going to measure the output voltage. So whenever the distance is applied at the arm which is connected to the soft iron, so here the soft core iron core position will determine the magnetic flux that is developed across the secondary windings S1 and S2, so which finally determines the output voltages S1 and S2, that means ES1 and ES2. So due to the difference of these two values, we will be able to obtain the magnitude of amount of the voltage in response with the application of displacement, and phase is determined by the sign, that is either positive or negative sign obtained in the output result. So if it contains positive output voltage, so then the source and the output values are in phase. Otherwise, if the output voltage is negative, so the voltage source which we have applied at the primary winding will be out of phase of 180 degree in the output.